All right, now this is, I preached this sermon some years ago, but this time it'll be video recorded, and I hope somebody in India will watch it and go, hey, I like that, you know, that's my dream. Okay. The following letter was written to President Andrew Jackson on January 31st, 1829. Dear President Jackson, the canal system of this country is being threatened by the spread of a new form of transportation known as railroads. The federal government must preserve the canals for the following reasons. One, if boats are supplanted by railroads, serious unemployment will result. Captains, cooks, drivers, hostlers, repairmen, and lock tenders will be left without means of livelihood, not to mention the numerous farmers now employed in growing hay for horses. Two, boat builders would suffer and tow line, whip, and harness makers would be left destitute. Three, canal boats are absolutely essential to the defense of the United States. In the event of the expected trouble with England, the Erie Canal would be the only means by which we could ever move the supplies so vital to waging modern war. As you may well know, Mr. President, railroad carriages are pulled at the enormous speed of 15 miles per hour by engines which, in addition to endangering life and limb of passengers, roar and snort their way through the countryside, setting fire to crops, scaring the livestock, and frightening women and children. The Almighty certainly never intended that people should travel at such breakneck speed. Sincerely yours, Martin Van Buren, Governor of New York. Now, certainly with hindsight, that letter sounds funny, but it illustrates what appears to be a universal human characteristic: resistance to change. You recognize this characteristic in your life, don't you? I mean, how many of us relish the prospect of moving, of changing jobs, of changing careers, of changing schools? Now, we sometimes say, I look forward to my new job, my new house, my new mission field, whatever. But we don't mean by that that we look forward to the change. We're looking forward to the better condition we hope to gain by enduring the pain of change. Change is a negative factor in the analysis of whether we should move, should change jobs, should change schools, etc. I mean, that negative can certainly be overcome, but that's the point. It's something to be overcome. As people, we are resistant to change. Now, there's no question that change is upsetting and stressful. We recognize that fact when we speak of culture shock or culture jolt in terms of missionaries to foreign countries. In fact, about 40 years ago, a man named Alvin Toffler, he died not too long ago, he wrote a book entitled Future Shock, in which he predicted that serious anxiety-related problems would accompany the increasing rate of change in our society. His thesis was, we just don't tolerate change very well. We even express our resistance to change in modern proverbs. Don't rock the boat. Don't upset the apple cart. Don't make waves. Go with the flow. And as one old saying puts it, come weal, come woe, my status is quo. Now, the intensity of our resistance to change can very easily increase with age, or with the length of time we've been stagnant. The longer we've stayed in a certain position, the deeper our roots and the greater the pain of change. Our modern proverb for that is, you can't teach an old dog new tricks. Now, there's no virtue in change for change's sake, in changing just to be changing. But our resistance to change becomes harmful when it grips us so tightly that we refuse to make beneficial or even necessary changes. When, for instance, the members of the Kipsigi tribe in Kenya, they refused to give their children medicine to cure their illnesses because they had always relied on folk remedies. Well, at that point, change has reached a harmful level. Now, I suspect that's where many of us are in our spiritual lives. We are hyper-resistant to change. We are refusing to make changes that are essential for our spiritual growth and welfare. We're unwilling to endure the pain of change, but that pain is a necessary part of spiritual growth. A prayer titled, "Help Me to Say Yes," includes the following. "I am afraid of saying yes, Lord. Where will you take me? I am afraid of drawing the longer straw. I'm afraid of signing my name to an unread agreement. I am afraid of the yes that entails other yeses." Now, I think that well expresses the truth that the decision to become a Christian, the saying of yes to the Lord Jesus Christ, is a decision to accept a lifetime of change. It is a yes that entails a lifetime of yeses. It is a yes that accepts a lifelong struggle against spiritual inertia and complacency, against settling into a comfort zone in which no further changes are required. I mean, that's what growth and maturing in Christ is all about. It involves change. We are commanded in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 1, to be imitators of God. And since Jesus is, as the writer of Hebrews put it, the exact representation of God's being, it should come as no surprise that Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 1, to imitate him as he imitates Christ. Be imitators of God. Christ, the exact representation of his being. Be imitators of me as I imitate Christ. So we are called to this growth in Christ-likeness. We're told in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18, that the life of Christians is marked by a transformation into the Son's likeness. And I like Leon Morris's comment on this call of Christians to grow in Christ-likeness, to become more and more like their master. Morris says, "It is God's plan that his people become like his Son, not that they should muddle along in modest respectability. We should be in no doubt as to the high standard that Paul sets for Christian people. We've been admitted to the heavenly family. We are brothers in that family / and sisters, and we call God Father. We are accordingly to live as members of the family, and that means being made like our elder brother." Now, it is toward that end of Christ-likeness that Jesus makes his uncompromising call to discipleship. In Luke 14, 26 and 27, Jesus very pointedly, he tells the crowd traveling with them, "If anyone comes to me and does not hate his father and mother," Semitic idiom for love less. "If anyone comes to me and does not hate his father and mother, his wife and children, his brothers and sisters, yes, even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. And anyone who does not carry his cross and follow me cannot be my disciple." Jesus must be the supreme authority in the life of a disciple. He must be given complete and unqualified authority to mold us. There can be no off limits. There can be no out of bounds. There can be no hidden closets. Christ must be trusted with total control of our lives, however painful it is for us to change. We must be willing to make whatever changes He calls us to make. We must be willing to do that. He seeks in that only to bless us. In the terminology of the prayer that I quoted, we have said the yes that entails other yeses. Now, despite the fact that we have been called to and have said yes to a life of change and growth, we find that our resistance to change has followed us through the baptistry. We tend to resist change at each step in the process. Now, the first step towards change or growth in any particular area is recognition of our need to change. That's step one. The Bible calls this being convicted or cut to the heart. Until I recognize and admit that I have a problem, I will never change. See, if you've ever heard members of Alcoholics Anonymous speak, you know that they realize their journey to recovery began with the admission, I am an alcoholic. It began with that admission. As long as they were willing to deny their need for change, to deny there was something wrong, they continued to remain in their condition. Now, conviction is more than a question of knowledge. It's not simply knowledge. David knew intellectually that it was sinful to commit adultery and to have an innocent man killed to cover it up. But he somehow avoided applying that knowledge to his own life. It took the prophet Nathan in 2 Samuel chapter 12 to penetrate David's veil of self-deception. The writer of Hebrews says in chapter 3, verse 13, he warns of being hardened by sin's deceitfulness. See, in order to be convicted, I have to expose myself. I have to expose my heart to the word of the Lord, and I must maintain an open heart, a heart that's willing to see problems and weaknesses. A heart that doesn't have such pride that refuses to entertain the possibility that I am living wrongly and doing something wrong. If I block all of that, if I'm not open to that possibility, I'm not exposing my heart to the Word. In the words of Jesus, I have to have ears to hear. And this is where our first line of resistance to change is. The first step in change is conviction. The first line of resistance to change is here in the matter of conviction. We simply avoid seeing any problems and seeing anything in our lives that needs to change. Some months ago when I was teaching 1 John, I told you the story about the frontier settlement in the West whose people were engaged in the logging business. Well, that town, they wanted a church, so they built a church. They hired a preacher. And the preacher had been there for several months when one day he noticed the members of the congregation intercepting logs that a town upstream had floated down the river. And he watched them saw off that town's brand and brand the logs or mark the logs as though they were their own. It was like cattle rustling, but with logs. So the next Sunday, he preached a forceful sermon on the text, "Thou shalt not steal." And at the close of the service, the people lined up. They shook his hand. They praised his sermon as usual. But the next week, he once again saw the members of the congregation stealing logs. And that really bothered him. So the next Sunday, his topic was, "Thou shalt not saw off the brands of thy neighbor's logs." And at the close of that service, they ran him out of town. You see, we need to ask ourselves some hard questions on this point. How often Do I expose my heart to the Word? Do I open my heart to sermons and Bible lessons, interacting with the messages and seeking a personal application? Or do I refuse to let the Word of God penetrate by either ignoring the lesson or figuring out how it applies to somebody else? Have I heard so many lessons in my life, the thousands and thousands, that I've just quit listening? It's just like noise. We have to ask ourselves that. Do I open my heart to the Word in personal Bible study? Do I study the Bible at home? And if so, do I read it seeking the Lord's Word for me? What is the Lord saying to me today in this ancient text? What is the message for me? And do I do that? How do I react when a brother or sister corrects or rebukes me? Do I flare up with this sense of, who are you? Who do you think you are? Do I flare up with that kind of arrogance and pride? Or do I humbly listen in the criticism to the voice of the Lord? Is the Lord using that brother or sister to get my attention about some blind spot that I have? Each of us needs to ask, how long has it been since I've been convinced of a need, convicted of a need to change anything? My giving, my attendance at church, my evangelism, my praying, my speech, my involvement with other Christians, my attitude toward other races, my hospitality, my relationship with my spouse, my relationship with my children. Now, if it's been a long time, we need to ask why. Is it because we are fully mature in all of these areas, or is it because we have lost our ears to hear? The second step towards change or growth in any particular area, the first one is conviction. The second step towards change or growth in any particular area is commitment to change. The Bible calls this repentance. And it's important to realize that this is different from being convicted of the need to change. Being convicted, being cut to the heart, being sorry for our failure, that merely sets the stage for repentance. It puts one in the valley of decision. See, when I'm cut, now the question is, what will I do with that? I've been convicted that I'm in fact in the wrong. I'm doing wrong. Well, now what will I do? The question then becomes whether I will do what I know is right. Will I fully resolve in my heart to be finished with what I've just been convicted of? Will I make that decision? I mean, Peter made clear this distinction between conviction and repentance in Acts chapter 2, verse 37 to 38. As you know, the people there, they were cut to the heart by Peter's sermon. They were convicted of their offense and they wanted to know what they could do. And Peter instructed them to repent and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. Paul also made clear this distinction between seeing the need to change, between conviction and actually committing to change. Repentance. He makes that distinction clear in 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verses 8 through 10. Paul there reflects on the fact that his previous harsh letter had made the Corinthians sorry for what they'd been doing, but he rejoiced in the fact that their sorrow, their conviction of wrong, led them to repentance. He rejoiced in that fact. See, conviction of wrong, that was the precursor. That was the predicate for repentance. Now, most people in Alcoholics Anonymous, they knew that they needed to change for some time before that decisive point in their lives. when they committed themselves to never drinking again. In fact, I've heard one of them refer to that event as his Declaration of Independence. That was his moment of repentance. And this is our second line of resistance to change. We have the idea of conviction as the first step in change, first line of resistance. Second step in change, repentance, second line of resistance right there. We either convince ourselves that recognizing our problem and feeling guilty, that is repentance. See, we convince ourselves of that. I just feel terrible. I shouldn't have been doing that. So we either convince ourselves that that is repentance, or we convince ourselves that we don't really need to change after all. And each of us needs to ask some hard questions on this point as well. Are we peacefully coexisting with practices and attitudes that we know the Lord wants us to change? Have we grown so weary of the constant struggle to be conformed to the likeness of God's Son that we've ceased fighting? Well, if so, we've made an idol of the status quo. Do we rationalize not changing practices and attitudes that we know are wrong because we see other people around us engaged in those practices and reflecting those attitudes? Do we look more to the norm of the church or the culture than to the Word of God? And if that's the case, we've allowed other people to become our standard instead of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, the final step in the process of change or growth in any particular area is implementing the change. Perhaps a better label for that would be follow through. Now, this differs from repentance in that repentance is the commitment of the heart to change. Follow through is the actual change. Follow through is the fruit of repentance. This difference is illustrated in Acts chapter 26, verse 20, where Paul tells King Agrippa that the message he preached was that people should repent and turn to God and prove their repentance by their deeds. See, there's a distinction there. As there's a distinction between conviction and repentance, there's a distinction between repentance and implementation or follow through. Now, we recognize that difference. We recognize that difference when we think about all the New Year's resolutions which we've made that started out with a bang but fizzled far short of the goal. Or maybe a diet that we were committed to following that we abandoned the third or fourth day. We understand the difference between repentance, or this intention, this genuine heartfelt level intention to carry something out and actually following through on that. It's not an alien concept. This is our last line of resistance to change. You see, as the process of producing fruit of repentance, as that process turns into daily, dull trench warfare, instead of a quick fix, our old way begins to look much less offensive. We begin to convince ourselves that our commitment to change was really rash. There never was a need to change. You know, now that I've thought about it some more, there really wasn't a need to change. And there are some questions that we need to ask ourselves at this point also. How many commitments to change have we made in the last 1, 2, 3 years that we've gone back on? And what kind of help have we sought from brothers and sisters in Christ to follow through on our repentance? Have we let our pride keep us from getting help so that our good intentions die on the vine? Now, much more could be said about the details of following through. But a key thing to hang on to is the fact that God is able to change us. Be honest before God. Stay in the battle, and God will grant the victory of change. We are not doomed to the status quo. As Paul said again in 2 Corinthians 3:18, we who with unveiled faces all behold the Lord's glory are being transformed into His likeness with ever-increasing glory, which comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. In Revelation chapter 3, verses 19 and 20, the Lord says to the church in Laodicea, "Those whom I love, I rebuke and discipline. So be earnest and repent. Here I am. I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will go in and eat with him, and he with me." The message is the same for each one of us. Jesus wants us to change. He wants us to grow. He wants us to become more like Him. And toward that end, He knocks on our door and He calls out to us. And we must be listening for His call. We must be sensitive to the voice of the Master. And when we hear it, we must be willing to let Him come in and let Him have His way with us. Now, if you've not been sensitive to the voice of the Lord, all I can do is ask you to change, exhort you to change. Listen for what He wants you to change. And if you have heard the voice of the Lord, please don't ignore it. Don't close your heart to it. Open the door of your heart and surrender whatever it is that you're holding on to that the Lord is putting His finger on. Let that go. And if we can help any of you with anything, it would be our privilege to try as we sing this song. Sing the one. Trust. Oops.